Good morning. I'm keen that we get underway as quickly as we can. I hope you all had a pleasant evening yesterday. For those of you like me who are at the Cutty Sark, it was stunning. Not just the ship itself, but the after-dinner speech from Ranulph Fiennes will stay with any of those who heard it, I think, for the rest of their lives. So this morning, I'm very excited about this session. We're dealing with the question of trust in the medical profession, how it can be maintained, nurtured. And the way it will work is that our speakers will have about 20 minutes each, and then we will open it up to questions. So we've got quite a lot to get through in the next hour. But before we do that, I've got some questions for you, four questions, which I'd like to get a quick vote on. So you've got your pads, hopefully. They will appear as if by magic. Okay, so let's just do these four quick questions. In your country, do you believe the medical profession is, now select one, A, more trusted by the public and patients today than it was 5 or 10 years ago, B, less trusted than it was 5 or 10 years ago, or about the same? So if you could vote, please. And how are we doing on that? Okay, so it's less trusted, 55%. I can just read the figures. 55% say less trusted, about a third say the same. So majority feel it's less trusted. Next question. Which of the following statements best describes your country? A, the public no longer trust their doctors and expect more or better regulation. B, the public show high levels of trust in their doctors, but still expect more, better regulation to maintain trust. C, the public believes doctors should be trusted and there should be less regulation. Or D, don't know. That's the first don't know option we've had. okay, so if you could vote on that, please. Slightly slower votes this morning. I think people, it's a few thick heads. Okay, and the results? All right, so very clear. 67%, the public show high levels of trust, but still expect more or better regulation to maintain it. Third vote, please. Right, this is simple. Do you believe there is, in your country, too much medical regulation, B, too little, or about right? And if you could vote, it'd be interesting. We're asking a group of regulators, so it'll be interesting to see what their result is. and let's have, I wonder whether, oh, well, there we are. Now, why does that not surprise me? Something about Sherlock comes to mind. Okay, and the last one, is trust in the regulator essential to maintaining trust in the profession? Yes, you can't have trust in the profession without trust in the regulator, or B, no, you can have trust in the profession without trust in the regulator. So if you could vote there. Okay, so it's a two-thirds, one-third split. Yes, no. Okay, we'll make of that what you will. Let's get on to our speakers, two very distinguished speakers. We have Baroness Honora O'Neill, a philosopher. Among her many roles, she's chair of the Equality and Human Rights Commission. She's on the board of the General Medical Council and chairs there the Ethics, Regulation and Public Involvement Committee of the Medical Research Council. Sorry, not the General Medical Council. That would be interesting.
News to me.
Sorry, the Medical Research Council, I do beg your pardon. We also have Sir Robert Francis QC, a barrister, specialist in medical law, who's chaired many inquiries into failings in the health service, including probably the most significant of recent decades, that into the scandal at Midstaff's NHS Trust. So, Sir Robert, I'd like to ask you to speak first.
Well, good morning, everyone. And
looking around the audience, it looks as though I'm feeling a bit fresher than you lot, but than I wasn't here last night. But I will try and keep you awake. But what will be a sort of general take, partly from my career, but partly starting before it, of where we've got to with medical regulation and whether we're in the right place or not. In 1894, which I have to tell you is a little bit before I started in practice, what was then the General Council for Medical Education and Registration had to decide whether a doctor who had written an allegedly defamatory article about other doctors was guilty of infamous conduct in a professional respect. Remarkably, through modern eyes, a medical member of the Council of the Medical Defence Union was also a member of the General Council Committee, which heard cases, although he had the wisdom to stand down from this case because the complaint against the doctor had come from the Medical Defence Union. As now, the Medical Defence Union had the purpose of defending doctor, but as described in the law report from the appeal from the decision to erase this doctor, the purpose of the union was that it was a society formed for the defence of the honour of the medical profession and to protect that honour against the improper conduct of any individual member of the profession. Now, I must admit I ought to, but don't know whether that is still in the purposes of the MDU, and it may well be. But it's a remarkable thing that there was a society of medical members whose purpose was to protect the profession against the improper conduct of individual members of it. The court had to decide the meaning of infamous conduct in a professional respect and ruled that at least one form of such conduct was that if it is shown that a medical man in the pursuit of his profession had done something with regard to it, which would, and I emphasise this, be reasonably regarded as disgraceful or dishonourable by his professional brethren of good repute and competency. In other words, the judges of misconduct were firmly identified as members of the profession. This was regulation, but self-regulation, by a collegial and presumably well-intentioned group of professionals. Well, I might not have been practicing in 1894, but I was in the 1970s. And by then, the language may have changed, but the environment was much the same. Hearings took place under a stained glass window commemorating some of the great presidents, starting with those in the 19th century. And the committee itself was still chaired by the president of the council. And members were, I think, all medical when I started. And the committee certainly enjoyed their lunch in the middle of hearings, with wine, I have to say, and they enjoyed sharing that lunch with the barrister appearing for the council to prosecute cases, but not, I regret to tell you, the hungry chap appearing for the doctor. By this time, the words of the charge were changed to serious professional misconduct, and the meaning was subtly changed too. This was said to be conduct connected with the doctor's profession, in which he has fallen short by omission or commission of the standards of conduct expected, and such falling short as is established should be serious. In other words, this wasn't just a matter of what the professions thought of each other, but it was the more objective test. And it was for the committee to decide what was serious. However, to begin with, the committee, I think, was entirely of medically qualified people. But after a short period of time in my career, at least one lay member turned up on the committee. Today, the gateway is to what is still called a sanction is whether fitness to practice is impaired through misconduct or various other things. There's usually a panel of three or four, the majority of whom may well now be non-medically qualified. Therefore, the fate and regulation of doctors is now potentially in the hands of members of the public rather than their own profession. We've moved from self-regulation and the trust that is necessary for that to work to external regulation. The GMC sees its purpose, looking at its motto on its logo, as working with doctors, that's first the part, and secondly, working for patients. Personally, I'd prefer that to be, as president of the Patients Association, should put the other way, you know, the sentence about patients perhaps should come first. And the stated purpose is our purpose is to protect, promote and maintain the health and safety of the public by ensuring proper standards in the practice of medicine. And the medical profession, however, has not been singled out for this journey from self-regulation to public regulation, the external regulation. Even lawyers, I'm afraid, are subject to the same process in this country. But it's also right to say that regulators themselves here have not been trusted. The result is that we have super regulators. The GMC itself is now the subject of supervision from the Professional Standards Authority, which looks at nursing and other healthcare professional bodies as well. So far, I've only spoken of the regulation of the medical profession itself, although similar developments have taken place with the other healthcare professions. When I started to make those timid appearances before the GMC's Conduct Committee, health service organisations, hospitals, general practices and so on, were not subject to regulation as such, but as far as hospitals were concerned, to a top-down command and control system, and so far as general practitioners in the community were concerned, a semi-statutory form of contract. Now we have not one, but two regulators for hospital service providers, the Care Quality Commission and Monitor, and one of those also covers community service providers, adult social care and mental health. There's a multiplicity of other regulators. One of my challenges during the Mid-Staffordshire inquiry was actually to try to work out how many statutory regulatory bodies had some form of responsibility for the activities in hospitals. And I gave up counting when I got to about 20. Some say it's very much larger than that. So why have we moved from a simple self-governed system of professional regulation to the complexities that face us today? I believe it can be associated with three things. Firstly, the growth in the recognition of patient autonomy, and that's part of a wider recognition of consumer and individual human rights, and the rejection of the traditional paternalistic culture, which has suggested that the doctor always knows best. Secondly, the reduction in the level of trust the public and politicians have in professions to govern themselves and to put patients' interests ahead of their own. And thirdly, the continual politically driven reform of the National Health Service. They've been too numerous to list here, but principally in recent times, the move to dissipate the authority and power in the system to autonomous units while leaving a command and control structure in place for the financing and commissioning functions. Now, I could trace the increased recognition of patients' rights to decide on their treatment through an analysis of legal cases, but this isn't the place to do that. In any event, to be fair, the profession has itself, in the last half century, developed an increasing awareness of the importance of involving patients in their treatment and providing the service in partnership with them. Unhappily, the need for professions and the organisations that provide the service to accept that patients, in effect, should lead the discussion or in relation to the decision-making process, and that they are entitled to make their choice from the available options, has not kept pace with the public's expectation that they will be involved and won't be expected to treat doctors as godlike figures. And this dissonance, I think, between the public expectation and what's been provided for them in this regard has resulted in a reduction in confidence. There have been some seminal moments on this journey. The Griffiths reforms introduced management concepts into the service which were alien to doctors, and some would argue have led to doctors sitting back and refusing, not taking the part that they were expected to take in the running of the system. That, I believe, is now changing again. The Bristol Children's Heart Surgery scandal, which led to the Kennedy inquiry, was one in which Professor Kennedy, identified a club culture amongst senior doctors, which permitted concerns about patient safety to be ignored. But he also identified serious systemic failings, which were really just as responsible for the tragedies in that scandal as the exclusive collegiality point. There was the dreadful case of Dr. Shipman and the confirmation of the serious dangers of undue deference to doctors. There's the Alderhay body parts scandal and the exposure of a misuse as already bereaved families found that they had been excluded from knowledge and consultation about the use of the human tissue of their loved ones. And later, and sadly, the mid-Staffordshire scandal and the wake-up call that that produced for all concerned. Taken together, these produced a repeated picture, which has led to the public being more questioning of professional authority and entitlement to dictate treatment and to lead health service organisations. In any event, increased dissipation of the control of health service, as I've said, has led to a perceived need to substitute for that control a regulatory safeguard. So why is regulation needed? If it is needed, what is it expected to do? And whether has it been effective? I believe it is most definitely needed, and this audience obviously agrees. Experience shows, sadly, that professionals are not always very good at policing themselves. Both mid-Staffordshire and Dr. Shipman, and indeed Bristol. The altruistic and selfless vocation which brings so many to medicine and other healthcare occupations doesn't always last. Standards will not always be met, and things will go wrong. Unless there is a system of effective control and supervision, these will go undetected. But the same also applies to organisations. There's perhaps less of a case for a regulator where there is a unified top-down system which included performance management and oversight resources at all levels. However, the greater the local autonomy, the greater the variation in standards and practice, and the more difficult it becomes for government and the public to establish what's actually happening behind the closed doors of the hospital. There are very few fields of activity which are safety critical and which don't have a regulator. Even in America, the CIA has an inspector general, or so it appears from 24. What is regulation needed to do? What is it needed to do? Firstly, to recognise that regulation cannot and should not be expected to do everything. It will not prevent all error and all harm. It will not preempt all mismanagement. And it's often erroneously expected to be a means of improving standards by a sort of supportive role and an advisory role. I don't think this works, because asking a regulator to be a policeman and an advisor provides an uneasy conflict which I don't think can be resolved. That doesn't stop regulators giving guidance, and of course they must always do that to provide clarity. Still less do I believe that regulation can replace the need for a culture in which mutual trust between patients and providers, and between professionals and their employers, and between healthcare providers and each other. This requires openness and transparency of the type I described in my report. It requires genuine and extensive involvement of patients and the public in the decisions about service provision, both on an individual and a collective basis. It requires a freedom from fear that raising and addressing safety and similar concerns is more disadvantageous than covering them up. It requires a shared acceptance that what is good about for the patient is good for the individual professional and the organisations they work for. So without derogating from these or other similarly important features of a patient-centred culture, I believe a regulator can reduce the risk of harm to patients by steps including defining minimum standards below which providers and individuals and organisations should not fall, identifying how compliance with such standards can be monitored, by combining intelligence, measurement, assessment and inspection to determine whether the required minimum standards are met, informing the public and those regulated whether the standards are met, holding individuals and organisations to account for their non-compliance, and when a non-compliance with standards has been detected, taking steps to protect patients and the public until such time as the breach has been remedied. What I don't think a regulator can and should do is actually participate itself in the remediation process. It should stand back, I believe, from that. Clearly, our regulatory system in this country has not been consistently effective in achieving these aims. The scandals to which I've referred and others were missed by the existing regulators until it was too late. Systems regulators have identified deficiencies which have been corrected, which might otherwise have gone detected. So it's not all a bad story. But I do think our current system has significant weaknesses. Firstly, do we really need so many regulators? For example, if regulation is now not a matter of self-regulation, and if we increasingly recognise that service provision is a matter of systemic teamwork, then should we perhaps think of at least better coordination and a consistent approach between the many professional regulators? For a start, should we not look again at the reform mooted by the previous government of uniting the adjudication process for all healthcare professionals in the same tribunal service? I have found it difficult to understand in relation to the aftermath of mid-Staffordshire that professionals who were being held or being attempted to be held to account for actually the same set of circumstances were being dealt with by different professional bodies and often with different outcomes. I don't think the public will continue to accept that. On the other hand, standards, if they are to work, need to be owned and accepted by those who are regulated. Standards which are difficult to understand, where the route to compliance is unclear, are unlikely to be genuinely and effectively complied with. The General Medical Council's continued and commendable struggle to get decent revalidation going is perhaps an example of that. Formulation of standards must involve the professionals themselves and the providers in their, as well as the public. Do we need two regulators to regulate the hospital service? It was a lack of coordination and common understanding between two systems regulators that played a part in the mid-Staffordshire scandal. While great strides are now being made to improve the interface between the Monitor and the Care Quality Commission, is there perhaps a need for separation or duplication of some, at least, of their functions? But that perhaps is a question for another day. However, the question, if the question is, would we be safe without regulation at all? My answer is a definite and emphatic no. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes, and I'll go on the end.
Well, I've been asked to say a bit about trust, and at the beginning of the session this morning, you were asked some questions about trust in your various countries and trust in regulators. I found the answers very interesting, but I do think it was the wrong question. And the point of what I shall say is to suggest why questions about trust shouldn't be the first question we ask. They're very, very popular. Public opinion polls all over the place are constantly asking, do you trust? Do you trust school teachers? Do you trust greengrocers? Well, quite honestly, if anybody asked me, do I trust school teachers? You can substitute a medical profession if you like. I would say, to do what? And I would also ask, which ones? Because I trust some and not others. In asking these questions about trust, as the pollsters constantly do, we of necessity look only at generic attitudes. Generic attitudes to, be it doctors, be it school teachers, be it nurses, and so on. And answers to generic questions, unavoidably, aren't very revealing because you have to bracket all the evidence and just think generically. So my generic attitude to doctors may be trusting or not trusting, but the interesting question is, why should I trust this particular doctor for this particular purpose? When you get onto that terrain, you're beginning to think not about trust in the first instance, but about something far more important, which is trustworthiness. And I think if I have a slogan these days, it is, trustworthiness is more fundamental than trust. Trust or mistrust is a possible response. Now, what do we actually want? What we want to do is to align the way we allocate our trust to trustworthiness. My aim in life is to trust the trustworthy and to mistrust the untrustworthy. And I don't therefore think it is particularly sensible to aim for more trust in this life. You will all remember the story of the very well-named Mr. Madoff, who made off with lots of people's savings in the financial crash of 2008. Lots of people trusted him with their savings. Would it have been better if there'd been more trust? I suggest not. So we don't just want more undifferentiated trust. And questions about trust, I believe, invariably start us off at the wrong end of things. Now, I will come to regulation. If we want to secure trustworthiness, it's been generally accepted, and not just recently, that accountability and regulation are reasonable ways forward. But I think one has to sort of pick that up and shake it a bit and ask, what makes for a good system of accountability, a good system of regulation, and what for a poor one? Because we have heard plenty of examples of previous systems of accountability that weren't as good as they were imagined to be. And one always has to say, is that true in our times? What's gone wrong? Now, one of the things that people sometimes find consoling here, but it may not be consoling, is the medical professions aren't in this alone. It is a movement that is happening all through society that people are asking whether the systems for accountability are good enough, and very often there is some skepticism about whether they are. So I don't know whether companionship in misery is a bad thing, but it does at least give us a wealth of examples of why people have been concerned in many cases about the adequacy of a system of accountability to which they found themselves working. And of course, there are the egregious cases of failure. Failure, as for example, the Dr. Shipman episode illustrates most vividly, but also many other episodes in this country and elsewhere. But I think it might be better not to look so much at the instances of failure, although those are sort of low points, if we can put it that way, but to look at the systematic implications of having a system of accountability. I'm going to give you a medical example. Some time ago, I chaired a small inquiry into the safety of maternity services in England, Neil will remember, and one midwife rather brilliantly said, giving evidence, the trouble is it takes longer to do the paperwork than to deliver the baby. And we all recognize the sentiment there. I don't mind whether it's literally true, but she was saying what is happening is so burdensome that it distracts us from our central task. Well, that seems to me to be an unintelligent system of accountability if that is happening. And I suspect all of us can give examples from our own experience of cases where the system of accountability was eating up the time and attention that should have been going into the primary task of delivering a service. Now, there are different levels at which this can go wrong. One level at which it sometimes goes wrong is simply that people find themselves confronted by a system that creates what we call perverse incentives. It creates incentives to spend time doing the wrong thing or not to do the right thing. Another may be that it's so burdensome that people start, as we nowadays say, it's become a verb in the English language, we go for box ticking. We tick the boxes, but we don't actually do the task any better. Those would be the worst examples. But I thought that midwife was giving us a clearer view of what might go wrong. It is not just the cases of the perverse incentive or the if you like, faintly dishonest ticking of the boxes, or perhaps very dishonest ticking of the boxes. It is the distraction of professionals from their primary responsibility. And that seems to me something we should think about much more. How time-consuming is it? Those of us who drive desks, and I take it as regulators, many of you do drive desks, but maybe in the past you drove some other things, but you will know that you can give attention to a detail. You can read documents with care. It is your professional pride to be good at the documents. People doing other jobs may find all that prose very difficult, all those rules very difficult. And that is why, as we say, walking the walk can be a good deal more important than talking the talk, let alone, as it were, writing all the talk down in beautiful, beautiful codes, regulations, guidance, good practice advice, and the rest of it. We have plenty of that. And that, it seems to me, is one of the things that makes it advisable to involve lay members, patients, members of the public, much more, to reality test the feasibility of what is suggested as an adequate way of holding to account. If it isn't feasible for the person who is actually doing the job in the hospital or in the surgery to comply while also doing a good job, it is a bad bit of accountability. So I think that it's very helpful to have lay comments on these sorts of things. Now, you may say, oh, but we don't expect the people actually doing the job to read this stuff. We expect it to happen at a different level. We expect it to happen, the hospital administrators will do it, or the professional leaders will do it. I think one has to get very realistic about what actually has to reach the people who are doing things on a daily basis with and to patients. Now, let me go back to trust. Trust, it seems to me, involves a judgment. If you are the patient and you want to decide whether to trust the doctor, what do you do? Well, patients are very clever, and I know some of them ask that very useful question, knowing that the doctor is not meant to direct their decision-making. Doctor, what would you do if it was your wife, husband, daughter, son? And they sort of get the expert view by an indirect question. But if they can't do that, what are they to do? They are confronted with content that they can't really understand and follow. They are told they have to give informed consent. How can you give informed consent to that which eludes your understanding? Maybe because it's too technical, or maybe because you're feeling too frail and weak, or other reasons. I'm talking here about the patient who is, as the phrase goes, in the full maturity of his or her faculties, not about the patient who is incompetent. The competent patient maybe is put in a difficult position of not being able to follow it. What can we do? Well, we've tried lots of things, and I would say that if we're talking about how to communicate trustworthiness, we'd be on the right page. Not trust, trustworthiness. That's what the patient has to judge. The patient has to judge several complicated things. I would reduce them to three if I was being simple-minded about them. One has to judge the competence of the medical practitioner, the honesty of the medical practitioner and what he or she says about what's going on, and also their reliability. And I won't go into why reliability doesn't reduce to competence and honesty, but I think it's necessary. How to establish it? There you are. You're the patient. To be handed your file notes is, to say the least, daunting and not very helpful. But this is where I think communication comes in. And I'm perhaps a bit countercultural in that I don't think transparency is a substitute for communication. It may be necessary, putting the information out there, but it isn't actually sufficient. Now, if we want communication, we've got to find simpler ways of communicating. And on the whole, it has to be communicating, not putting the information out there. That's mere transparency. And I think that on the whole, we will find that people are pretty adept at using an opportunity to communicate to check and challenge. And those are the two words I would emphasize rather than transparency. The patient has to be enabled, or the patient's family, or the public representatives, have to be enabled to check and challenge what is said to be adequate, what is proposed, and so on. Now, I have an extremely good monitor here, but the first digit is falling off. Is that 9 or 19?
That's 9.
That's 9, excellent. I'm a lucky woman. So if we get down to check and challenge, I think we have started on the route to seeing what is needed for judging trustworthiness. Will trust follow? People are always asking that question. What can we do to restore trust? And I think some of your answers to the questions at the beginning of this session suggested that in your countries it might have been a question people asked. What can we do to restore trust? I'm skeptical about that very idea of restoring trust, partly for the reasons that I gave at the beginning, but let me now go in a little bit further into the idea of restoring trust. First, that word, restoring, makes it sound as though once upon a time, in a golden age, everybody wholly trusted their doctor. Well, was that the case? I don't know. We have all sorts of literature from the past that, to my ear, suggests a much more varied situation. So I don't think we should beat ourselves up by feeling that we have fallen from grace in our times and that in the past everything was wonderful and people were entirely trusting of their doctors, and of course doctors were all as good as gold and entirely took the interests of their patients seriously and the rest of it. But if we look at these statistics, which are very influential about supposed levels of trust, which I've said are just looking at generic attitudes, they don't actually suggest much change from the past. There are a few people who have a less trust, a few professions that are less trusted. But I don't know whether you find this consoling. If you look at the time series for trust polls, you will find that the people who came bottom 20 years ago come bottom now. That's the politicians and journalists in this country and most countries. And the people who come top are the people who came top 20 years ago. And this will cheer you up no end, because judges in this country, not every country, doctors, nurses, elementary school teachers. However, before you get too pleased about all that trust in doctors, in this country there is a persistent difference between the level of trust in GPs and the level of trust in what the polls call hospital doctors, consultants. Now, I believe that gives us a little bit of a clue as to what is actually going on in those polls. The hospital consultant is a remote and intimidating figure. The hospital consultant is one you see rather briefly, and maybe you don't even remember all the questions you've been worried about in the previous 2 weeks. The hospital consultant is much less trusted than the GP. Now, I wouldn't actually worry. 10 years ago, I was giving some BBC lectures called the Wreath Lectures, and I gave one of them in the clinical school at Addenbrookes. There was a lady in a wheelchair, and she was obviously a patient. She was also in a dressing gown. And she got the mic, and she put her question, and it was, and I didn't know it wouldn't be broadcast, so I was being jolly cautious. Her question was not really a question. She said, "I don't trust surgeons, and what is worse, my operation has been postponed for 3 weeks." And I thought, well, if I'd been alone with her, I would have said, "You must be so pleased your operation has been postponed." But afterwards, I tried to think through, what did she mean? Because she clearly did trust surgeons. She was willing to put her life in their hands and have her operation. Indeed, she was eager to put her life in their hands. But she had a suspicious attitude to surgeons, nevertheless. Probably quite right. So when we hear that "I don't trust," we always have to listen. What's really behind that "I don't trust"? Is it a judgment or is it merely an attitude? This lady is such a beautiful example because she had a judgment which was out here and an attitude that was out there. Now, I believe that's fairly common. So what can we do to help people bring their judgments and their attitudes closer together? Well, the first thing that seems to me important is not merely to have adequate forms of regulation, but to make them intelligible to the people who have to make the judgments. And that, I'm afraid, is where it often goes wrong. People feel, regulators, well, I can't understand what it is that they are achieving. There have been, of course, many, many attempts to make what regulators do more intelligible to the public at large, have what you might call user-friendly ways of representing the same evidence. I will use an example from what we do in schools in this country because it just distances us a little bit from the medical context. We have had school league tables, and that has led to some very undesirable educational practices. In order to bring your school up the league tables, you have to achieve a certain examination profile in your pupils. Well, how to do that? First of all, a very clear piece of prudent manipulation of the matter is to prevent those children who are likely to get really bad results from taking those exams, so they won't be counted in the league tables. That has gone on. A second one might be to encourage pupils where they have options, and our system gives them a large number of options from age 14, where they have options to take the easier subjects. So guess what? They have to do maths, but they don't have to do a modern foreign language. So many more don't. And we halve the number of 14 to 18-year-olds doing a modern foreign language by simply making it optional and then just relying on the self-interest of the schools to do this. It was an unintended consequence of giving pupil choice. There are many, we also make the very bright children do far too many exams because they'll bring the average number of A's and A stars up. League tables are not an innocent way of representing what is going on. They create their own expectations of gaming the system. And that, I think, is quite a challenge to regulation, because it is very important to get at the really poor performers, to think about the hospital that has the lowest safety standards, the GP who is no longer fit to practice, to get those people from harming away from a position where they can harm patients. So there, I think, is a conundrum that intelligent regulation can probably solve. That is, how to eliminate the really poor performers without distorting the activity of everybody that everybody else is engaged in. And I suppose that that is something that I throw to you as a challenge. What could you do to get to the poor performers without wasting the time and wasting the talent and destroying the morale of all the people who are not disasters, or all the hospitals that are not disasters? So I think of this as a matter of securing intelligent forms of accountability. Intelligent, first of all, in that they should be intelligible to the lay person. They should be able to understand them. What's the point of them? And that is, I think, difficult. Do you know, on my side, this is stuck at 9 minutes. Can I ask you what time it actually is?
To wrap up fairly shortly, that would be wonderful.
No, it's just
I think it's a Usain Bolt. It's giving you milliseconds as well as seconds.
Well,
it's,
unfortunately,
it's good for 100 meters.
Unfortunately, the minutes have fallen off, I think. So I will stop. I think you can see intelligible accountability, which is not a matter of transparency, but actually has to be communicated to the people who in the end count. Thank you very much, and I'm sorry I lost count.
Well, thank you both very much indeed. Come and sit, Honora. I realise we're tight for time, but I very quickly just want to ask you first a question, Sir Robert. Now, as president of the Patients Association, which I omitted to say when I introduced you, you dropped a little hand grenade in your presentation there about this idea about unifying regulation of health professionals, which is something that does happen. It's a model in many countries that we've heard from in the last couple of days. With your hat on from the Patients Association, do you think that would increase trust in the medical profession and other professions? And do you think that the current system, how confusing and intimidating is it for patients?
Well, dealing with the second part of that first, it's very confusing. My experience, both from the Mid-Staffordshire Inquiry and the correspondence I see coming through the Patients Association, is that people have no idea where to go. If you say go to the GMC, it's a revelation to them. If you say go to the Care Quality Commission, they don't know who you're talking about. If you say go to monitor, they think you're talking about a school prefect. There's that confusion. So I believe that having more unification will make it easier for the patients to understand. But the challenge, of course, and I fully accept this, is that no regulation, rather for the reasons that Fiona has mentioned, is going to work unless it's fully understandable and capable of implementation by those who are regulated. And that, of course, requires a deep understanding of the nature of the work of all these professions, and therefore one can't get away from that. But I do think that when it comes to an adjudication or a regulatory intervention in relation to the professions, it doesn't make much sense to me that the same event requires several regulators to get involved and all do different things. And it's the same with the organisational regulators. We see it day in, day out now. Both the care quality and monitor are both undertaking regulatory activity in relation to the same place. They both do inspections. The people who are inspected have to provide different information to both and behave in different ways. And just for the reasons that are being mentioned, that's taking them away from the job rather than making them do the job better.
Very quickly, isn't there a danger, though, that we would end up with even more upheaval? And one of the things that I'm sure you would agree is that if we constantly change the way systems are organised, the health service has never got a chance.
I agree. I'm not suggesting this is an overnight process, and I never did, if I say so, in my report or indeed my remarks today. But it is a question, I believe, of evolution and of understanding. But in relation to the actual adjudication process, we so nearly got there. There was this bonfire of quangos, which of course was to be applauded in general terms, but why on earth they abolished the one quango, the new quango that seemed to make sense and was going to actually make things much cheaper and simpler, I just don't know.
We've got four microphones in the room, but before I take questions, Honora, can I just ask you, do you fear that regulation sometimes actually gets in the way of professional ethics and really prevents professionals from doing the job they want to do?
Yes. I mean, it no doubt also often stops bad things. So I'm not saying that is all it does. But ill-designed regulation, multiple layered systems of regulation don't help anybody, least of all patients.
Okay. So questions from the floor, please. Yes, there's... the front row down on the far side there.
Thank you. I want to say one of the biggest challenges I think we face and all of us face is the fact that on the one hand we have patients being educated as consumers, so what they do with their, for example, which phone they want to buy, a private disposable income, that is absolutely fine, but they have the same attitude now when they come to publicly funded services which are actually structured to deliver towards for the needs of a whole population, a range of people, for which in austerity measures there's very little money available. And I think there's a real conflict now between what people have been educated to expect that they can personalise and make us, if you like, as adaptable to their own circumstances as possible, and what they're experiencing within the healthcare system is something which is really being resource-wise very thinly spread. And I think that's part of the conflict.
Well, the reason for that, if I may say so, has been because the health system, because of its top-down structure, has always acted or been behaved on the basis that it provides things, in effect, for the convenience, that in a way that suits the convenience of the organisation, not reflective of the needs of the people who use it. And a classic example of that is that we don't have a proper communication system between doctors and patients. Appointments are made without anyone thinking whether the matter could be dealt with over the telephone, for instance. We make people go to hospital because there isn't anything available in the community. A lot of the care, wonderful care that is provided, would be so much better provided if we reversed that and actually constructed what we provide by way of healthcare in the way that reflects individual patients' needs rather than reflects the convenience of the organisation.
Yes, I think that's right. I think you were raising not individual patient need, but individual patient preference. And I regard that as rather an important distinction, that if we're to have a health service that's going to be fair, then we really do have to enable doctors and other providers to stand up and say, no, this is what can be provided.
Can I ask both of you about the lay involvement? It's been one of the big themes in this conference, the drive, this momentum towards more lay involvement in regulation. When we talk about that, I mean, is it sometimes sort of lip service towards lay involvement in regulation?
Well, I'm all in favour of lay involvement, and one of the real struggles, it seems to me, at least over the last 20 years, has been to find ways of making that a reality. And if I may take the example of the fitness to practice panels, which, as I say, now have often majority lay involvement. But actually, when you look at who it is who's the lay member or the lay members, they're often actually not lay at all. They are retired healthcare professionals. Now, I've got absolutely nothing against retired healthcare professionals or retired managers, but I'm not entirely sure that's the sort of lay involvement that we're always looking for. The other type of person is someone who may be an architect or something else, but is retired, and actually spends his or her entire time supplementing their pension by going from one regulatory body to another. And so they become professional regulators themselves. And that, again, is not quite, I think, what we're always looking for. It's a very valuable thing for people to do. But actually, what we're trying to get at is that patient voice. What is it that patients expect in a particular circumstance when they see a doctor in front of them?
I think certainly at the Medical Research Council we are increasingly clear about the distinction between public involvement and patient involvement. Public involvement, I think, is subject to exactly those problems that it gets captured by a quasi-professional group of lay people. They are technically lay, but of course they have this desirable experience but narrowness of background. Patient involvement is a rather different matter, and I think is well nurtured by different sorts of organisations, including all sorts of patient support groups, and also I would say that the medical research charities do a terrific job in putting people who are dealing with a certain range of illness in touch with one another and enabling them to have a network. I have some faith in the thought that one of the better uses of social media may come to be the genuinely lay involvement where other lay people act as the interpreters. And although I don't belong to this, I'm told by lots of friends that Mumsnet is rather a good example of this going on. So if we want it to be lay, let's have it genuinely lay.
Yes, I was talking to an oncologist a couple of weeks ago who's in a very specialist area, and he was saying that there's a group on Facebook, a closed group, and they tell each other when he's going to be next on duty because they all want to see him. And so in a sense, they know before he does, more or less, when he's going to be in the hospital. So it's very much in terms of patient empowerment. But in terms of putting patients first, we've heard that for decades, yeah, from health secretaries and heads of the NHS. Are we any closer, do you think, to patients really being put first? Because there's always this sort of political driver where we talk about patients being at the heart of what we do. Are you confident, Robert, that things are improving now?
I think there's an improved recognition. I think that's absolutely genuine. I don't think it's any more longer just a matter of lip service. But I think we're a long way from getting to where we need to get to. And I agree entirely that I think that we need to explore all sorts of imaginative ways of finding out what patients want. I went to an opening of a specialist clinical centre earlier this week, which part of the architectural design of that had been informed by actually asking teenage patients what they wanted in their rooms. And there were the teenage patients, and one of them, believe it or not, was they were able to change the colour of the lights, which actually is great fun. But so that's one imaginative way, whereas a sort of body of lay representatives who spend their time going from body to body would never have thought of anything like that. So I think that we need to find different ways, in imaginative ways, and what that way is will change according to the purpose of the organisation. But we've got a long way to go. The attempts at public involvement over the last 20 years, which I've actually traced in my report, there have been many attempts. None of them, I'm afraid, have been any better than before. And I think maybe because they actually confuse two things. One is actually finding out what patients actually think, and the other is then expecting the patients themselves to be the experts in how to make that change happen.
What would you like to see, Nora, in terms of harnessing patient views and increasing trust in the profession?
Well, as you see, I stand back from increasing trust in the profession as an objective. I think the profession should aim to increase trustworthiness, and that because it wouldn't be any advantage to increase trust if you were just increasing trust in the untrustworthy. So increasing trustworthiness seems to me to be the proper aim here. If that's done, it will be very irritating if the response is not greater trust. But I think that as professionals, you have to take that on the chin. It can happen that one improves trustworthiness and doesn't get the due reward of being much more trusted. One can have people being very suspicious despite the fact that one is really doing everything in their interest, consulting them and all the rest of it. So I would say one just has to be a bit grown up about that. Maybe one isn't going to be trusted, but if one's trustworthy, then one's done one's bit.
I agree with that, and I think that we're on a journey, actually. And I agree entirely with what you've said about trustworthiness. We can all be misinformed into trusting, and I believe a lot of that, I'm afraid, happened in the past, what I was talking about. People trusted, their trust was misplaced because of misinformation or lack of information. So we are on a journey where more information is becoming available, and it's important that that information is made understandable to people who aren't scientists and aren't doctors. And that in itself will produce actually a reduction in trust to begin with, because actually the information will show a reality which is different from that which people have previously believed. But I think they will then become educated in the way that most people can be into what's possible and to what's desirable, and they're not always the same. And then we can have an intelligent conversation about what it is the public actually want to happen. At the moment, too often, public are told things are happening when in reality they're not.
Do you think that we have too much or too little regulation as it stands now? We obviously have many, many layers, but would you like to see it simplified and actually result in less regulation, but at the same time fostering good practice?
Well, I think that we need greater clarity about what we're trying to achieve through regulation. And my view is that what regulation is better at is in effect being the policeman who defines with clarity a set of minimum standards, which we would hope, below which level we can't really permit anyone or any organisation to fall. Where I think regulation has less of a contribution to make is in the sort of things which encourage regulators to produce ratings, overall ratings this is, of a type which produces league tables and perverse results and targets. So I think the regulators have a role in exposing what is bad. I think they have a role in actually informing people how things are performing. But I don't think they have a really helpful role in actually taking a part in the process of improvement itself. I think they should be there to declare and to intervene to protect people. But the job of actual improvement should be somebody else's.
Nora?
Yes, I would generally agree with that, and I think that what you said about non-duplication is extremely important in this. It's a waste of everybody's time when you get a duplication either of regulations applying to a given area or of bodies that are adjudicating on that. But just a slight warning, it is extremely difficult to build regulation down. We've had in this country for 20 years an outfit that was initially called the Better Regulation Task Force. Yes, you laugh. But then it was a unit, and now it's an executive, or the other way around. The only, the Dutch have a very nice ambition that for every regulation you put out, you must take two in, remove them. Now, the only case I know where that has worked is in the Republic of Ireland, where we had too many licensed premises, too many bars. And
is that possible?
Listen how it's been dealt with. It took 20 years, but it was so clever. In order to get a license to open a bar, you had to buy up two. And that worked a treat. And you no longer find those little shops with a bar in the back of the shop as a supplementary source of income.
What a shame.
Well, a few of them, but not so many. And I think that the trouble is you can't count regulations. And when people say, oh, take two in for each one you put out, it sounds nice. But, of course, you can put out something which has 500 clauses and take in something which had 10 clauses. So a simplification, a reduction of the number of bodies, much better signposting for people who have to find out where to raise an issue, but I'm not sure there are mechanical ways of reducing it.
One thing I think one can do without reducing, and I think it is good to reduce if you can, is to stop mission creep. I mean, it is, of course, we all think we're doing a wonderful job and regulators are no different from anyone else. And therefore, they tend to sell themselves as being able to do rather more than they're already doing. And often governments, when a problem turns up, think the best way of doing it, something about, or being seen to do something about it, is to create another regulation. And the regulators, I think, perhaps are just a little bit too willing to say, oh, yes, we can do that. And I think perhaps regulators could do the public a favour by occasionally saying, I'm really sorry, we're not going to deal with that, we can't. And if you want to do it, find another way of doing it.
Well, I think that's a very good point on which to end this really fascinating session. So Baroness and O'Neill and Sir Robert Francis, thank you.